2 days ago, the Hayli Gubbi volcano in Ethiopia unexpectedly produced one of the largest explosive eruptions the entire African continent has seen in a millennia, and now there is a chance that some volcanic ash from the eruption could even fall on Mount Everest. As strange of a series of events as this might sound, the ashfall on the world's tallest mountain is a possibility per Vac to lose. As the remnants of the ceased major eruption plume is expected to drift over parts of Pakistan, India, Nepal, and Bhutan in that order, with a chance for a few stray ash particles to fall on Everest between parts of November 24th and 25th. Still don't believe me? Well, although part of this satellite image is cut off due to a daily coverage gap, here is an image of the eruption plume drifting over parts of far northeastern Oman into the Arabian Sea. This ash plume has become more diffuse over time, but managed to drop enough ash on parts of Yemen, Eritrea, and Ethiopia to notably darken the ground. I am personally estimating that the average thickness of volcanic ash in the darker regions, totaling an area about the size of the Dominican Republic, to be around 2 millimeters thick, albeit much higher closer to the source eruption vent. If this were the case, then approximately 0.09 cubic kilometers of tephra was emplaced, along with 0.02 cubic kilometers of tephra from the emplaced pyroclastic flows. That would mean this eruption just barely crossed the lower threshold on the Volcanic Explosivity Index scale as a 4, representing the second largest explosive eruption in Africa in the last millennia, or the 13th largest since the Holocene epoch began. If you are curious why photos of the eruption plume show two distinct plumes, that is because lower elevation winds sent drifting volcanic ash to the north-northwest, while upper elevation winds blew in a different direction to the east-northeast. And yet, despite what many geologists, including myself, expected, the dramatic eruption has either recently ended, paused, or dropped to such a low activity level that it isn't detectable on satellite. Activity could theoretically intensify again soon, but there isn't enough information to make a decent guess. Regardless, way too many news sources are claiming that the November 23rd eruption marked the first eruption of a Hayli Gubbi volcano in either 10,000 or 12,000 years. This is most likely false, and here is why. The Holocene geologic history, or period which began in 9700 BCE, of the many volcanoes in the Dinakil Depression is understudied, meaning we do not have a decent idea of when each of these volcanoes erupted, apart from observed historical eruptions. The Hayli Gubbi volcano, much like the Ilbagu volcano 9 kilometers to its west, had no known historical eruptions. And yet, both volcanoes contain semi-fresh-looking darker black basaltic lava flows on their flanks, which presumably erupted at some point since 9700 BCE, we just don't know when. In other words, this is the first confirmed historical eruption of the Hayli Gubbi volcano, but ignoring the potentially still ongoing eruption of Hayli Gubbi, both it and Ilbagu have probably erupted at least once during the Holocene epoch, although this is not technically a confirmed fact. Thankfully, there are no confirmed casualties from Hayli Gubbi's eruption. In hindsight, it appears that precursor activity began on November 17th when sulfur dioxide emissions increased. Some locals later noticed gas rising from near Hayli Gubbi a few days before it erupted. Also, a correction. Hayli Gubbi's eruption did not begin at 8:30 a.m. local time, but rather 11:22 a.m. local time. The initial phase of its eruption was seemingly its largest, lasting for 2.5 hours, with 5 other weaker phases occurring during portions of the subsequent 5 hours. In my opinion, I am not fully convinced yet that this eruption truly has ended, as if it did actually end already, it would mark the shortest volcanic eruption rated on the Volcanic Explosivity Index as a 4 or higher that I am aware of. As a final note, I would like to thank my YouTube channel member Mark S. for supporting my work.